A warm welcome to everyone. It is wonderful to have you all here on the occasion of the Civil Services Day. May I take this opportunity to introduce the dignitaries on the dais. Mr. Chokalingam, the Divisional Commissioner and President of Society of Civil Servants of Pune, is chairperson of the program. Mr. Magdum is the Director of the National Film Archive of India and the General Secretary of the Society of Civil Servants of Pune. Professor Parshikar is an academic and social and political scientist. He was a renowned professor in the Department of Politics and Public Administration at the Savitribai Phule Pune University from 1989 to 2016. He is also a regular columnist for the Indian Express and the Times of India. Mr. Girish Kulkarni is a national award-winning Indian film actor, writer, and producer. He is well known for Marathi films such as Valu, Vihir, Deul, Gabri Cha Paus, and Jaundyana Bala Saheb. His latest release is the Bollywood blockbuster Dangal. Mr. Prashant Girbane is the honorary director of Pune International Center. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks. Just a quick interruption. As part of the inaugural session itself, the opening itself, we appreciate that there are many stars on the stage here now, I can say, and many off the stage as well. Given the fact that it is the Society of Civil Servants, there are many, many senior civil servants here, and also many very senior retired civil servants here. May I request one of the senior most civil servants here, and we are very honored that Mr. Nimbalkar is here among the audience. Sir, could we please request you to come on stage and welcome the guest today with a tiny token of appreciation. We'll request Mr. Nimbalkar to please trouble you to come here on the stage for a moment. Thank you. If you could help with that, please. Sir, I could request you to please give a tiny token of appreciation to Professor Polshikar, Professor Suhas Polshikar. And may I request you to please, sir, also welcome Mr. Girish Kulkarni. Thank you so much, sir. It's an honor to have you here and to have all of you here. I'll request Yuganti to please proceed with the rest of the program.
Thank you, sir. I now request Mr. Magdum to please come up and deliver his welcome note.
As you all may be aware, Civil Services Day has been being celebrated since 2011. On 21st April, in fact, yesterday and today there was a grand function in Vigyan Bhavan in Delhi where Prime Minister addressed the gathering. So we thought of joining hands with Pune International Center. I'm really glad that they came on board in terms of hosting this event. We are also happy to have Professor Suhas Parshikar, who is a renowned political commentator in the country, to give his remarks on the democracy and bureaucracy and uncomfortable coexistence. In fact, apart from the Society of Civil Servants of Pune, I understand that the PIC also has many members who have been from the civil services. So it's great to have all of you. We also are happy to have Girish Kulkarni. In fact, he has been touring around the state with his new play, but he readily accepted our invitation to come and share his thoughts. I would say that one of the very rare actor and activist actor director. So we are very happy to have him here. The idea behind the Civil Servant Society is to come together from time to time, share ideas, and get to know each other so that there is a camaraderie. And so that's why we thought of coming here in Yashoda to celebrate this occasion. Welcome all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I now request Mr. Chokalingam to please deliver his opening remarks.
Professor Palsikar, Mr. Kulkarni, and my dear colleagues, senior officers. I won't take much time because we have started a little bit late, but it is very important to note that an intellectual organization like PAC, Yashada, which trains the civil servants for the state as well as for some of the important departments of Government of India, along with Civil Servant Society of Pune, which consists of civil servants across various services, All India services as well as central services, and the group of retired All India service officers. So basically we have put three civil service societies together, or organization together, along with an intellectual organization to celebrate the Civil Services Day. Once in a while, we take to intellectual functioning intellectual lectures, and we are really happy that Professor Palsikar has agreed to give a lecture on the topic which is in everyone's mind. Normally, it is easy to berate bureaucracy, but it is time to hear from an analytical mind of the best order about the bureaucracy as well as democracy. And it is an outsider view. It is not an insider view, even though it may be best, but it is biased. It may be biased, but it is taken to be biased. You cannot be a judge of your own case. So you are taking a view from outside, and you are not taking a view from a person who is prejudiced, who analyzes the politics and overall administration at its best in the country. We look forward to your speech, Professor Palsikar, as well as interaction with Mr. Kulkarni. And I won't take much time. I really welcome all of you to the event. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I now request the keynote speaker, Professor Palsikar, to please address the audience.
Mr. Chokkalingam, the other colleagues on the dais, and the august audience. It's indeed a pleasure and also an honor to be amongst you this evening, for the simple reason that while, yes, you are right that it is easy to berate the bureaucracy, everyone is still at the same time somewhat jealous of bureaucracy as well. And therefore, to break the barriers of the civil services and to be speaking to them is indeed an honor. So thank you very much. I am somewhat in an awkward position, not just because I am speaking as an outsider, as Mr. Chokkalingam pointed out, but also because to speak before a celebrity in order of speaking is a hazard. It's a hazard because you're only standing between the audience and the celebrity for another 25 minutes or 30 minutes. Nobody is going to listen to you. People are just saying that, okay, politely, we wait till your turn is over. So I will live with that hazard and maybe speak for whatever time that I can and whatever time that you can tolerate. About the topic. Yes, there are ways and ways at looking at bureaucracy, and I'm using the word bureaucracy because, as many of you must know, the famous Max Weber uses that term and tries to understand a phenomenon, not just an organization, but a phenomenon. And let me therefore begin as a framework for what I want to say later, by quoting Weber. He was a dense writer. He used to write very long sentences, so this quotation is also bound to be dense and longish. He says, democracy as such is opposed to the rule of bureaucracy in spite of and perhaps because of its unavoidable promotion of bureaucracy. So two things he is saying. One, he is saying that there is an inherent opposition between democracy and bureaucracy. and we'll maybe find out why it is so. But at the same time, he is also saying that still democracy promotes bureaucratization of societies. So there is a kind of symbiotic relationship between the two as well. So while on the one hand, there is a kind of opposition, tension between the two, and that's why I have titled this as an uncomfortable coexistence. So they coexist, democracy and bureaucracy coexist. The coexistence is uncomfortable, but they also sort of live off each other. The first proposition in this framework, therefore, that we can make is the following, that democracy requires bureaucracy, and not just in the sense that a political master requires the babu. No. Democracy requires bureaucracy because, as we shall see in a minute, they both emerge out of a common principle. So democracy requires bureaucracy. However, number two, and that is where you might disagree with me, bureaucracy requires democracy. It is possible, and historically one can cite examples of bureaucratic authoritarianisms of the Stalinist variety. Or one could read George Orwell's 1984. Even then, I would venture to say that bureaucracy requires democracy, because if bureaucracy in the true Weberian sense is to be bureaucracy, then it would need only democracy and nothing else. There cannot be bureaucracy in a non-democratic authoritarian setup. And again, I shall come to that. And then third, in spite of this relationship of mutual interdependence, the two might clash with each other. Bureaucracy and democracy might clash with each other. And it is the exposition of these three formulaic principles that I would be doing in the next 15 to 20 minutes. But to begin with, what is so common between bureaucracy and democracy? As practicing or retired but eminent civil servants, I need not tell you that one of the basic founding principles of any civil service, as we understand it in the modern sense, as Weber understands it in the sense of bureaucracy, is rule of law and equality before the law. And historically, these are precisely the principles on which democracy is not only founded, but democracy emerges out of these principles. The moment you accept that there will be a rule of law and not rule of men or women, the moment you accept that there shall be political equality, one man, one vote principle, or one person, one vote principle in the 20th century, you have, in a sense, inaugurated democracy. So rule of law and equality before the law, being a common link between democracy and bureaucracy, there is obviously a mutual interdependence of the two. There is a symbiotic relationship, I would say, because then bureaucracy would strengthen itself because of democracy, and democracy would be stronger with the help of bureaucracy. It is this relationship of the democratic and the bureaucratic cultures, it is this relationship between the two phenomena that should actually form our basic understanding of this tense relationship between the two. Then why is it, very quickly, that the two might clash? If they are sort of products of the same environment, if they are products of the same thinkings, the same principles, why should the two be clashing with each other? There are many reasons why they should clash, but there is an interesting point why they would clash, and that is the source of authority. Organizationally, the bureaucracy as an organization understands that the source of its authority is skill, the source of its authority is competence. And these are all words that we often use in connection with bureaucracy. It is the technological or technical skill. It's not technological, but technical all the same. So skill and competence constitute the source of authority for the bureaucracy. Apart from, of course, the fact that bureaucracy draws its larger sustenance from the idea of rationality. On the other hand, democracy draws its sustenance, its authority, from the idea of the public, the people. So there is a sentimentality attached to the public. In principle, in a democracy, people can never be wrong, even if they decide to exit EU, even if they decide to partition a country, people can never be wrong in principle. And it is this source of authority called public sentiment, the idea of the public, acceptance by the public as a larger unit, that puts democracy and bureaucracy in a situation of confrontation quite often. As a result of this, and on this very auspicious day, I shouldn't be saying this, but as a result of this, the image of the civil service and the police in our country is less than positive. We had two surveys, one in 2005-06 and another in 2013-14, and I will not go into the statistics, but both show that there is a negative image of the police, that is, people don't trust the police. And in the case of the civil services, there is only a marginal trust. That is to say, if three people trust, two distrust. That's the relationship as far as the civil services are concerned. Therefore, instead of going into the theoretical framework propounded by Weber, I would now, in the remainder of the time, address a limited question. And the limited question is, why does Weber's prognostication of the relationship between democracy and bureaucracy obtain in India? So what is the specificity of the Indian situation in which democracy and bureaucracy seem to be confronting each other, where MPs and MLAs, for example, sit at the throats of the bureaucrats and the bureaucrats keep dallying when decisions are to be taken? Why is this so? That is the question. And I will give you four answers. These are obviously not exhaustive answers. There can be many more answers. But just in order to understand the Weberian paradox, I am placing before you four possible answers as to why, in the Indian context, the democracy and bureaucracy as phenomena keep clashing, confronting, and living in a permanent situation of tension. Number one, I would say, is the good officer syndrome. You know, when you want to say something good about someone, you say that he is a good officer. So it's not that you are an officer, but it is a good officer tag which is valuable. And to me, this tag, pardon me, those all of you who are all obviously good officers since you have turned up here this evening, this tag is problematic as a principle of the structure of bureaucracy. Because bureaucracy is structured on the idea that there will be no personal element. In fact, as Weber taught us and generations of students, anonymity is the hallmark of bureaucracy. So the good officer tag obviously violates anonymity and distinguishes persons as persons. So increasingly, since the 1970s probably, and I'm just hazarding this, but since the 1970s in India's bureaucracy, there has been more and more personalization of bureaucratic honors, powers, as well as villainous roles. So the good and the bad both are personalized. Officers are too much in the limelight. And in these days of overexposure by the media, this limelight is always dangerous, not to the officer, but to the office, to the structure, to the organization. So there is too much personalization when we say that this officer did this. We always keep talking about frequent transfers of officers. We know that, you know that. But why is it that people say that this officer is gone, therefore now things would be bad? Because obviously then it means that there is only something personal, not in the system. So bureaucracy is obviously not functioning as a system, it is functioning only as personal capacities and personal interventions, which contravenes Weber's idea of rationality, because then there is an element of arbitrariness, then there is an element of discretion. So this is one probable answer. The second answer why there is a tension between the two is not the doing of the bureaucrats. It is probably our larger social doing, and that is our misconceptions about democracy. As a society, we understand democracy probably often wrongly. What is the idea of a good politician? We talked of the good officer. Studies have shown that the understood role of a political actor in the Indian context is someone who can get things done. So it's not representation. It's not the evolution of public policy. It's not the shaping of public opinion, but it is getting things done locally or nationally. It is this getting things done image of the politician which is probably a wrong image of the politician, either as a middleman or as a 16th century emperor. That the king can do something, so you go to the king, was it Jahangir, and you ring the bell and you are responded to. If I don't get a school admission or if I don't get a railway ticket, and if the railway minister does it, it's not a great thing in a country of democrats. It's a bad thing for the democracy. That why should this have to happen? Why is it that our systems don't work either in government offices or in the public sphere? But it is this general understanding, the public collective understanding of democracy, which is probably putting bureaucracy and democracy against each other, because then the democrat, the political actor, is constantly trying to get things done, whichever and whatever way. One of the most insidious expressions of this democracy, which many of you unfortunately might have faced, is vigilantism. That a crowd would barge in and say that this is what the public wants. This is the right thing. This is what the public wants. You have to do it. This kind of vigilantism, either for a good cause, bad cause, or whatever, is a wrong idea of democracy that we nurture, we entertain, as a result of which the symbiotic relationship between bureaucracy and democracy starts becoming parasitical instead of symbiotic. But there is one more way in which we dangerously understand democracy, and that would be my third answer, and that is about procedures. Why is it that I want to get things done through a politician? Because I want to probably bypass procedures. So then the more serious question is democracy not about procedures? Is it that bureaucracy is about procedures and democracy is not about procedures? Is this a right formulation? And if you stop for a moment and think of democracy, you would suddenly realize that there is some distortion happening here. Because democracy originally emerged because we wanted procedures. Look at elections. And what else are elections if they are not procedures? If you didn't have procedures, then elections would be a farce. And we take pride in India that our elections have been successful all these years. And there is a famous story which Ramachandra Guha writes in his book about the first election, where election officers actually went using not only camels and elephants, but also rhinos in Northeast to reach the polling stations so that elections would happen on time. Now, this procedural insistence that certain things must be what they are laid down in the Constitution is the hallmark of democracy. And in insisting on democracy merely as a raw expression of public sentiment, we probably lose on this procedural aspect of democracy quite often, very often. So while democracy is about public sentiments, while democracy is about public explosion of views, it is also about channelizing those sentiments through procedures. And our democratic politics, our political parties often fail doing that. So while, as I said, on the one hand, there is this side to the confrontation, there is this other side of probably some misconceptions about democracy that we hold. To put it in a short and formulaic manner, I would say, and summarize these points number 2 and 3 simply as our democracy becomes only a play of sound and fury. If you can shout loudly, democracy is on your side because public is on your side. If I can shout as much as somebody else cannot hear others, then that is democratic. Or alternatively, if I have sheer numbers, whichever way I might have collected those numbers, then numbers win every time. Of course, in a democracy, numbers matter. Otherwise, you cannot have elections. But even then, in spite of having the importance of this number factor, you need to remember that democracy is something more, and that is where we now come at the end, the fourth answer as to why there is this confrontation and is it a true confrontation or not. Leaving aside the misconceptions, the real issue about democracy or the real essence of democracy is to construct, shape, and then execute public interest. But this is all right saying in one sentence. In reality, it becomes intractable. And that is where probably the most important rub lies in the relationship between bureaucracy and democracy. Both falter because as a society, we have increasingly failed to construct public interest. There is nothing called public interest in our country, increasingly. For a variety of reasons in which I need not go, you are quite conversant with them, but we are increasingly becoming a democracy of communities rather than democracy of citizens. So rather than citizenship, my membership of various communities, and these communities need not only be in the North American sense ethnic communities. That is to say, these need not only be in terms of caste or religion. I'm talking of all sorts of intractable, irreconcilable differences in our society, and they are becoming more and more irreconcilable. This inability of our society to bring together different interests and to forge a common ground among them is probably the most important constitutive element of the confrontation between democracy and bureaucracy. And that is why I thought that apart from the failures of bureaucracy, apart from the failures of conceptualizing democracy, probably we are somewhere reaching a situation where the idea of public interest on which democracy is founded, and also the idea of public interest on which the administration is supposed to be functioning, is becoming non-plausible. Whenever one comes up with something as a public interest, and land acquisition is probably one of the best examples or worst examples of this inability to bring together conflicting interests. The type of industrial capitalism that has evolved in this country has eminently failed to convince those at the receiving end that there may be light at the end of the tunnel. It is a plundering kind of industrial capitalism. It's a crony capitalism, yes, but also a plundering kind of capitalism which we live through, as a result of which, unfortunately, we cannot have meeting ground unless you actually plunder Odisha. You cannot develop, period. It is this impossibility of the situation on the ground, on paper, that jars both democracy and bureaucracy. I thought that these are four elements of confrontation between democracy and bureaucracy that we might like to ponder on the occasion of the Civil Services Day, but also not just because we are civil servants or we are not civil servants, but just because we are into this joint venture called India's democracy. It's a joint venture. And because it is a joint venture, we need to take the Weberian paradox seriously, but not think of that paradox in abstraction as to what happens theoretically, not think of it in abstraction or either in isolation as to what happens in North America or in Europe, but to relate that paradox to our own conditions and our own situations in India. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. This concludes the first session. I request the dignitaries to please take their seats in the first row and we'll set the stage for the second session. Thank you.